everyone. I'm Sergey Vinogradov from Intel. So, and this talk will be about development perspective. We'll talk about our approach to design concurrent data structures for persistent memory. So, Usha and Steve introduce you how to configure persistent memory on the system, how to make it available for developers. And this talk is mostly from a developer point of view. So last 2 years at Intel, I have been working on a programming model for persistent memory and concentrated on the multi-threaded applications for persistent memory. And this talk basically covers two main parts. So the first one, I will compare two approaches to design thread-safe data structures. I mean, not thread-safe and concurrent data structures. Yeah, and we'll highlight some common points that I believe every developer will experience during development for persistent memory programming. So actually, in this talk, I suppose that you should know something about persistent memory programming because AMD already do a lot of work on talking about challenges, about supporting data consistency on persistent memory. So, and this talk goes further to the multi-threading aspects. So this is the outline of this presentation. So at the beginning, I will describe our goal, why we decided to do this work. Then we will look into the two approaches to support data consistency when we are developing concurrent data structures. Then I will present a concurrent hash map for persistent memory. So we have a lot more stuff privately, but since it's a public conference, so I'm allowed to present only what's already in the public. And at the end, I will show how this data structure used in PMMKV. It's our persistent memory key value storage. So develop it specifically for persistent memory to leverage all advantages of this new type of memory. So our goal was to design and to look into concurrent data structures, yeah, to explore how it is to port, for example, some existing algorithms to the persistent memory. So and what's concurrent data structures for persistent memory means? So the data structure should reside in persistent memory. So this is our initial goal. So this means that all allocations that data structures do does happens in persistent memory. So data resides in persistent memory because CPU allow it just to execute load and store operation directly to this type of memory. So all operations to this data structure should be thread safe, and it should allow us to concurrent execution of these operations. Yeah, and since it's a persistent memory, operation should be a fault tolerant. So for example, we should care about cases when we have some kind of crashes, power failures, system reboots, unexpected system reboots, and so on. So because persistent memory save its states, so on restart, data structure should be restored to the valid state. Yeah, it should be usable after restart, even in case of failure. So why we decided to do that? So because our Intel already announced a new type of persistent memory, call it Intel Optane DC persistent memory. So, and as for developers, we should create a software ecosystem just to leverage advantages of this new type of memory. And PMDK, it's a great product that provides a bunch of our low-level APIs like persistent allocator that allows you to allocate memory in persistent memory in fault-tolerant manner. It provides persistent pointers just to address in these persistent memory pools because regular pointers that use virtual memory, it's not applicable to persistent memory because on the process restart, we should be able to use the same pointer, so we should use persistent pointer provided by PMDK. And one of the major feature of PMDK, it's a PMDK transactions that allows you to build consistent applications, so to support data consistency in your application. But we decided to go further and to develop data structures. Yeah, it's more high-level abstraction for persistent memory because we as a developer always think when we need to build some application, yeah, we start thinking what algorithms we want to use, what data structures we want to use to store our data. So we believe it's important to create data structures for persistent memory. And this talk covers concurrent data structures, while PMDK already have some data structures, STL-like data structures for persistent memory, like persistent vector, persistent array, and so on. So what's already done? Yeah, so maybe I just need to rephrase this title, what's we already published, because we've done something more, but this is what is already available in open source. So yeah, we take Intel Threading Building Blocks library. Yeah, it's open source library for multi-threaded programmers. And it's similar to STL, but it's provide, for example, if STL provides single-threaded data structures like vector, queue, map, and so on, TBB provides concurrent data structures like concurrent hash map, concurrent vector, concurrent queue, concurrent priority queue. And we just take a concurrent hash map and redesign it for persistent memory. The code is already on the code review for PMDK, so it will be part of PMDK soon. And we integrated this data structure to PMMKV, as I said, so to enable concurrency in this key value data storage. Now, let's look to two approaches that we evaluated to build concurrent data structures. So we start from the transactions approach. So this approach suggested by PMDK itself, because PMDK already provides this mechanism to developers. So we evaluated it for multi-threaded application. And then we consider it alternative approach. I call it atomic approach, when we try not to use transactions, but we just switching atomically between consistent states. That's in case of failure, keeps data structures in some consistent states, and it allows us to restore to some valid states after crashes or unexpected events. So just an overview of what transactions mean. So I believe in the past, Andy presented a lot of similar stuff for developers. Yeah, it's just a brief example. So it's this example of linked list data structures implemented for persistent memory, and it uses PMDK underneath. So if you are not familiar, it uses persistent pointers, because as I said before, we cannot use regular pointers. Yeah, because on restart, we should be able to use the same pointer. So, but it's pretty easy data structure to demonstrate. So it's a linked list. It contains set of node linked together, head and tail pointer. And on this example, I just implemented pushback method that's insert new elements to the end of linked list. So, and with transactions, what we should do, we should define the set of operations that we want to do atomically, yeah, on some data structures. And in this particular case, there are two measure operations. It's memory allocation, and when we construct new node. And the second part is, the second step is insert this new node to the linked list. So we should check if head pointer is null, then we need to update head and tail. Otherwise, we need to update just tail, yeah. And this is the scope of transaction. We just create transaction, it's a PMDK code, and do required steps. So we allocate memory, update required pointers, and do commit. So PMDK handles for us data consistencies. What does it mean? So internally, PMDK creates write-ahead log to track all memory that you have changed in this transaction scope. Yeah. So in this case, we are allocating new node. It's tracked in the write-ahead log. We are updating head pointer. We are updating tail pointer. The old value of head and tail also track it in undo log. Yeah, that means that before any modifications, we just copy old value of the memory to the undo log. In case of failure, So PMDK on restart will automatically return the memory to the state before transaction begin. So in case of commits, in case we reach this point, so PMDK do required flushes. So it flush required cache lines to the persistent memory domain. So data became persisted. So everything is done. And write-ahead lock is clean it up. So that's it. It's pretty nice approach to support data consistency in your data structure. But when we go to the multi-threaded application, the things becomes more complicated. Yeah, let's consider this simple example when we have a multi-threaded application, just the two threads, that's concurrently going to update atomic counter. So it's pretty easy operation from the multi-threading point of view. Yeah, we have atomic operations that's part of C++ standard. So it's supported on the hardware level in, for example, in Intel CPUs. And but with our PMDK transaction, so the main point we should understand, and this is what we recognize during our work, PMDK transaction does not support isolation. What does it mean? So internally, PMDK creates one write-ahead lock per thread, and it's independent from each other. And what happens in this simple case, yeah? We create transactions, each thread create transaction, add old value to the write-ahead lock. So we add value of counter A to the write-ahead lock of thread one, and thread two do the same things, yeah? It takes the old value before modification, add it to the undo log, and then both thread just do increment operation. It's atomic increment, so it's from the concurrency points of view, it's absolutely correct operation, but let's examine what happens in case of transaction abort, yeah? So let's imagine that the second thread commits its transaction, and the first thread abort for some reason. Maybe it's a crash, maybe it's power failure, or maybe it's some exceptions that can be thrown in the middle of transaction, yeah? In this state, in this case, PMDK will restore old value, yeah? Because we have a write-ahead lock, and old value will be restored. So transaction should be rolled back, so PMDK will use write-ahead lock values and restore value of this counter. It's zero because it's logged. Yeah, but it's incorrect because results of thread two, so transaction is committed. So thread two incremented this counter, and it supposes this counter is not new anymore, yeah? But thread one on restore will overwrite the correct value of counter A. Yeah, so this is incorrect. And the outcome of this slide is that atomic operations is useless inside PMDK transaction. We cannot use it. So the possible solution, we need just to use a mutexes. We need to define a critical section. And furthermore, the scope of this critical section should, so we should acquire the lock before we add in a counter to the undo lock. And we cannot release it immediately, we increment counter. We should keep lock, keep mutex locked until we end the transaction. Yeah? Comparing to volatile case, we are increasing the scope of the critical section. So since I already started talking about mutexes, so this is another interesting point. So usually when we are developing thread-safe data structures, we intended to use fine-grained locking. Yeah, we are not using just one mutex. Usually we have several mutexes. For example, in case of linked list, it might be a mutex per node. In case of hash map, it can be mutex per bucket. So usually mutex part of some data structures. But since we have a persistent data structure that resides in persistent memory, mutex also reside in persistent memory. For us, as for developers, it means that every time we log the mutex, we change the state of the mutex. And in case of failure, mutex may remain locked on restart. Yeah, because if you lock mutex, do some work and crash happens, or power failure happens, so mutex will remain in the locked state. Yeah, because semantically mutex it's not a persistent entity. Yeah, it's a volatile entity because threads itself, it's a volatile entity in our workloads. Because thread runtime is limited to the by the process runtime lifetime, while persistent memory lifetime exceeds this scope. So we need somehow to restore mutex to unlocked state on each process restart. So fortunately, PMDK already solves this issue and there are two possible ways. First way, PMDK provides a set of persistent mutexes. It's the same type of mutexes like in pthread library. It's mutex, read-write mutex, spin mutex, and so on, but it's a persistent mutexes provided by PMDK. And PMDK guarantees that these mutexes will be restored on restart, restored to unlocked state. And the second solution, PMDK allows you to mark some fields in your data structures as volatile fields. What does it mean? That's on restart, PMDK will call some default initializer for your field. So in this particular case, PMDK will call a default constructor for the mutex. So, and it will be reinitialized by PMDK automatically on restart to some default state. So this is the two ways to handle this issue with mutexes. Another approach that we considered during our, okay.
Sorry to interrupt. How is the persistent mutex implemented in PMDK?
It's implemented in the similar way as this field and underneath. So actually, persistent memory pool has some internal variable, call it run ID. And when we accessing persistent mutex or when we accessing volatile field, PMDK checks the global run ID with run ID of this particular variable or with this particular mutex. If it's the same, then it's okay. If it's not the same, then we need to reinitialize mutex or volatile field to some initial state.
So the actual storage of the mutex bits is in persistent memory or is in volatile memory?
In persistent memory. Because usually we've...
issue instructions to compare exchange and others.
You mean synchronization mechanism?
Yeah.
It's a little bit complicated logic because to synchronize it, we cannot use mutexes, yeah, because we need to restore it to the valid state. But internally, PMDK use some log-free algorithm just to check the global ID with a local ID of some particular, for example, mutex. So it's synchronized, so it could be used in the concurrent environment. So alternative approach to PMDK transactions. So because we already figured out that building concurrent data structures with transaction will require some critical section that's in time exceeds critical sections that's required in world.
Going back to the previous slide.
Mm-hmm. Deallocating and allocating, it's about memory, yeah? It's not about the memory state.
So, like, my question indirectly is that do you need some sort of like garbage collection in the back to...
Actually, no, because in PMDK, it happens in the lazy manner. So when you access this variable, for example, this mutex, at this moment, PMDK checks if this variable should be reinitialized or it's already done for this particular run. So it's doing in the lazy manner. So alternative approach to PMDK transactions. So since we figure out that concurrent PMDK transactions, I mean correct implementation of concurrency with PMDK transactions, may cause scalability issue because we should increase the scope of the critical section. Yeah, we decided to evaluate a new approach and just to investigate how we can implement and design data structures for persistent memory without PMDK transactions. Yeah, still the same example of linked list, but right now pushback method implemented without transactions. So PMDK provides you two types of allocators. The first allocator, I used it in a transaction example. And the second one, it's a make persistent atomic. So it's a allocator that atomically allocates the memory and assign results of this allocation, I mean address of allocated region to the pointer that's user provided. So, and from the developer perspective, this function executed atomically. So, what we are doing in this particular case, we allocate memory, assign results of allocation to some pointer, which is part of the data structure. Then we check head pointer, update it if it's required, check tail pointer, else update it. And after that, since we have no PMDK transactions right now, we need to do a cache flushes manually. Yeah, PMDK provides you a way to flush any memory region from caches to persistent memory domain. So we allocate memory, update head and tail pointers, and do flush of head pointer, tail pointer, and tail pointer next. Yeah, just free cache flushes. But what if some crash happens in the middle of the pushback? Yeah, because it's not a transaction anymore. So the crash happens might happens in at any point of this method. Yeah, for example, we can allocate memory, but after that immediately it will be crash. So we have allocated node, but it's not inserted yet. So, but it's still consistent states because new node, it's part of our data structure. Yeah, on the restart. We should have a custom restore logic. So I created this method, call it restore, that should be called on restart. And internally, it checks new node pointer. Yeah. If it's not new, we should decide what we want to do. And I intentionally do not implement any particular logic because it depends on some particular data structures. Yeah. For example, in that case, if new node pointer is not null, it means that we already allocated this one, but have not inserted yet. So we need to proceed. We might proceed with insertion. Yeah. We need to complete this work on the process restart. So this is just a basic overview of this approach. And important point from the previous slide. Yeah. Since we have no transactions, we cannot use atomic allocator and assign results to any pointers that reside on the stack. For example, this is just a similar example. Yeah, we create a persistent memory pool, create a persistent pointer. This pointer resides on the stack, yeah? So pointer is just a variable. We do atomic allocations, assign result of allocation to this pointer, but what if crash happens at this point, immediately after this allocator completed his work? So since this is pointer on the stack, we will lose it. Yeah, on restart, we will have a persistent memory leak. So this is an important outcome that when we are using atomic allocators, we cannot assign results to pointer on the stack. And in this particular example, so we make new node part of list data structure itself to make sure that this address stored in this pointer available in restore function on restart. Since I mentioned that atomic operations are useless inside PMDK transactions, yeah. Someone might suggest that without transactions with atomic approach, we can build a log-free algorithm based on atomic operations. Yeah, because atomic, we atomically switch the state of the memory. Yeah, but things is not so easy even in that case because, for example, atomic operations on Intel architecture, they guarantee cache coherency, yeah, but it doesn't guarantee that data will go to the memory immediately. So we execute some atomic operation, for example, compare and swap, and there is no guarantee that it will immediately go to the persistent memory. So the data will be in the cache, which is not. And that's why we should think about memory subsystems as a two-domain subsystem. So the first domain is a volatile domain, which includes registers, CPU caches, and persistent domain, which includes DIMM itself, so memory controller, write pending queue, so as Andy mentioned before. So, and this is just a simple example. So let's imagine that, again, we inserting two new elements from two different threads to the linked list, to the tail of linked list. We use compare and swap to insert this new element. Let's assume that the thread one succeed first and inserted this new element. And the main outcome of this picture is that data changes made by first thread become visible to the second thread before it is persisted. Yeah, because compare exchange and cache flushes is not atomic. Yeah, it's two operations. So changes made by first thread with compare exchange becomes visible to the second thread before cache flush, so in this case CLWB instruction, is executed. So it might be an interrupt between these two instructions. So what does it mean? It doesn't mean that we cannot use atomic operations at all. The answer, we can do it, but it's challenging, yeah? In restore, for example, if we have some unexpected crash, so we should care about such cases when second thread did some changes based on the data that is not persisted. Yeah, and internally at Intel, we already have some data structures that's built with Locri algorithm, so I hope it will be published soon. So just showcase that it can be applied. Any questions about this slide? Okay.
So, just a couple questions. Let's say thread one finished and inserted its element, and then crash happens. So, persistent domain does not have that new element in there. Now, you say the restore should take care of that.
Yes. Yeah. So let's return to this example, yeah? As I said, so this is pretty similar. Since it's single-threaded example, it's pretty similar to a multi-threaded example. So in this case, results of allocation assign it to some variable, which is part of persistent memory, yeah? So result of allocation is persisted. So we have access to this element, but not through the list, but from, because on this, immediately after allocation, it's not part of the linked list, yeah? But these new elements access it from this pointer. It's already available. It's reachable, yeah? There is no persistent memory leak. So it's a very good question because in multi-threaded application, what we should have instead this one variable? Because we should at least one variable per thread. Maybe we need persistent thread local storage. Yeah, it's a challenge in this case. So, and in this particular example, so results of allocation of this node, it's persisted, but it's not inserted yet. And this is just a table when we try to capture outcomes of our comparison, so from three different point of view. So the first one is how it's easy to implement data consistency support. So as I mentioned, transaction, it's a very natural way. It's already used in the database systems. Yeah, when we just define scope of actions that should be done atomically, and that's it. PMDK responsible for data consistency, responsible for data restore in case of failure, and responsible for cache flushes. While with atomic approach, we as a developer, when we develop in some particular data structure responsible for data consistency, we should define what elements should be changed, what elements should be flushed, and just to make sure that we are doing it in a consistent way. And restore logic might be a little bit complicated even in case of single-threaded applications. But we found that it can bring you more performance because transactions, it's a common approach. It doesn't know nothing about your particular data structure. While with atomic approach, since you developed it for each particular data structure, you can do it in a more optimal way and avoid overhead to handle write-ahead lock. And from the point of multi-threaded applications, yeah, PMDK transactions doesn't support isolation. It's a main point you should know, and you should care about this. And this was done intentionally for performance aspects, and developer is responsible to properly use PMDK transactions in concurrent environment. So, and we choose atomic approach to implement concurrent data structures because it's most suitable from the performance perspectives. So, and this is our concurrent. Why not? It's provide. Oh, you mean, yeah, with that case, yeah, it doesn't provide isolation, but it just performs well. It doesn't kill your scalability because in case of PMDK transaction, you should define the critical section, which might be too long. Yes, but it does not block execution of the concurrent threads. Yeah, for example, in this particular case, first thread, insert element, and even in case it's not persisted yet, the second thread already doing insert also. Yeah? It's remain active. The second thread doesn't wait until the data will be persisted. It can proceed with execution, while in case of PMDK transactions, you should grab the lock and release it only at the point when you commit your transaction. Yeah, I understand. It's not really.
Can you just grab the log right before you make the change?
You can grab the log. You can acquire mutex before you start the transaction, but you should keep it locked under the end of transaction. So. Would it be thread safe? Yes, it would be thread safe. Would it be concurrent? It's not concurrent, yeah. Because it's serialized. Any other questions about these points? Okay. This is our concurrent hash map implementation based on TBB hash map. So internally it's set of buckets, yeah. It's pretty obvious implementation of concurrent hash map, and each bucket has its own read-write mutex. So, and there are actually two measure operation. It's find operation and insert operation. So find, it's a read-only operation. Insert, it's a modification operation, yeah. So for find, so we just need to find required bucket, acquire read lock on the mutex, and do the search inside, for example, inside required bucket. Yeah, so for the insert operation, we should do three steps. So the first one, it's a read step, so we need to find bucket. There is no modifications, we just find required bucket. Acquire, so I forget to mention that we need to acquire, yeah, we acquire write lock on this bucket. Then we can safely allocate a new node, and we have a special pointer in the bucket, call it new node. as with linked list example, yeah. We allocate new node, results of allocation, of atomic allocation, assign it to the new node pointer, and the last step, we just insert this new node to the linked list, yeah, to the appropriate position. So since we have a read, write mutex, and in case of insert operation, we have a write access to this bucket. So we make sure that no other threads goes to the same bucket until we complete our insert operation. The same technique used in TBB HashMap. We use the same, but we do it in a persistent way. Any questions about this? Okay. So now, at the end of my talk, I would like to introduce key value storage for persistent memory. It was designed specifically for persistent memory with intention to leverage all advantages of persistent memory. But in fact, what we see right now, it can be customized for any kind of storage. So actually, it's hardware agnostic from the developer point of view. So what it is? So actually, it's a key value storage that provides you C and C++ API. Also, it provides bindings to Java, Python, and Ruby languages. And on the middle, it allows you to create any custom engines. For example, right now, it provides two embedded storage engines. It's a B3 engine and KV3 engine. So it's just two different engines for persistent memory with different features. Yeah. What we did, we just take our concurrent hash map and embed it to PMKV is our custom engine. So right now, we have one more storage engine, which is concurrent. Yeah, it's enable concurrency in PMKV because these two is not thread safe. But since I said that it's a hardware agnostic, so for example, we can create one more storage engine, for example, for SSD, yeah, for NVMe device. But from the applications built on top of PMMKV, they can just transparently choose between the storage hardware, between persistent memory, between SSDs, between hard drives, and so on. And also, this K-value storage uses DBBench utility ported from RocksDB and from LevelDB, so it allows us to compare performance between PMMKV and some other storage, K-value storages. So, and this is the outcome of our integration. So, we integrate, as I mentioned, we integrated concurrent HashMap as a storage engine. So, and it enables maximum throughput because right now PMMKV support concurrent operations with this new engine. So, we can insert elements from multiple threads. So, it increases throughput. And what is, I think, more important, we keep P99 latency flat. So P99, it's, I believe, it's pretty obvious that it's very important metrics in data centers that our tail latency is not growing at all. We have growing number of threads. And here is our initial performance results. So I use it just to show the scalability. So the light blue bar, it's a throughput, it's operations per second. So x-axis, it's a number of threads. And we have a free benchmark. So the first one, it's a read random. So it's just do a read request to PMMKV from multiple threads. So and as you can see there, we have a almost ideal scalability with growing number of threads. And latency, which is a black line, it's almost flat. Latency is constant. In case of few random benchmarks, the picture is almost the same. So few random, we are randomly insert new elements from different threads. And again, throughput is scaled pretty well, and latency is pretty flat. And the last one, but not least, so read while writing benchmark, it's benchmark that's close to the real cases. So it exists in RocksDB, for example. So it emulates situation when you have only one writing thread and multiple readers. So and it stands to emulate a situation to and measure how only one writing thread impacts the read performance. So this is the reading thread performance while we have one writing thread. Yeah, and again, scalability is pretty good. Latency is flat, and this last benchmark just proves that write operation doesn't impact read performance on persistent memory in our implementation on concurrent HashMap. You can do your home exercise and compare it with RocksDB, because in RocksDB, this benchmark significantly decreases the read performance. Yeah, if you compare read random and read while writing on RocksDB, the picture will be different. So, summary. So, during our work, we compared two approaches to design concurrent data structures. So, we are not suggesting some of it as a good point to choose to design your data structures, yeah, because it's just our choices. And both of this approach has pros and cons. We choose atomic approach because it's just it performs well. We designed concurrent hash map for persistent memory, and some more data structures will come. So please use it. So try it, and we already embedded it in Pimium KV. So you can go to these links, try to use our data structure. So there is much more data structures in this repo just for the single-threaded cases. This is the first one for the multi-threaded case. And this is a link to Pimium KV project, so you can try it also and see how we integrated our concurrent hash map to Pimium KV. So provide your feedback, so just to submitting issues to this project. So we are always open to answer and help. So that's it. Questions?
I have one more question.
Uh-huh. From PMDK point of view, I'm not sure, because it's possible, since it's open source project, yeah, it depends just on priority, and if, the question was, in this talk I presented that, for example, Pimium KV has bindings to Java, Python, Ruby, and question was if we are planning to add support for Go language. So, I think it's possible, at least in Pimium KV, so we can do it if there is a demand. So just submit an issue to this project, yeah, and we will think what we can do. Question?
Is Pimium KV open software?
So the question is Pimium KV is open software? So yes, it's open sourced. So this is the link to the GitHub. So yeah, it's open software, and right now it's not a product quality. So we have a plans to productize it, I think maybe in the Q1 on next year. So right now it's an experimental. But we start working on productizing it. And
one more question about that. Does it support range queries?
Yes, cache? Yes. Yeah, actually, there was a talk on Monday about key value API standardization, and I figured out that API of Pimium KV is pretty similar to what was suggested in this talk. If you need any extensions in the API, just let us know, because right now it's on the way to productization, and we are very flexible to add new features or change our APIs by requests. So that's it. Thank you.